Hello everyone, welcome to StudyIQ. In this video, I will bring to you a very important government scheme that was announced in the budget of 2019 that was presented to everyone on 5th of July by the new finance minister Nirmala Sitharaman. This scheme is for the development of the fisheries sector in India. So not only we will take a look at what this scheme entails, but we will take a look at also the fisheries sector in India as a whole. So let's start the video. It is about the scheme which is called Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. Matsya Sampada means fisheries wealth. Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. So what is the objective of this scheme? It will establish a robust fisheries management framework. In India, the fisheries that we are all engaged in is still very traditional. There are glaring gaps that need to be addressed. So this scheme will address the critical gaps in the strengthening the value chain, including infrastructure, modernization of fisheries sector, traceability. Now traceability is a huge issue because the fishing these days is not very sustainable. You know, because of overfishing, the boats, the fishermen have to go much deeper into the oceans to catch the fish. And that is why traceability is a big issue. And we can improve the traceability using technology. Production, productivity, post-harvest management and quality control. So basically all the facets that are required to run a successful enterprise, right? All these facets will be improved in this multi-fold, multi-pronged scheme, which is Matsya Sampada Yojana. Essentially, we are targeting to develop the fishery sector in a very holistic manner, covering all the important aspects of operations. Before I go further, you should know some background about the fisheries in India. So we had something known as Blue Revolution. And Blue Revolution is a concept of rapid increase in the production of fish and also the marine products, the other seafoods like crab, prawn, shrimp, through package program. So it was called as Blue Revolution. Blue Revolution was launched in India during the 7th five-year plan, which ran from 1985 to 1990. And this was a time when the central government, they sponsored the Fish Farmers Development Agency that was entrusted with the growth of the fishery sector. There were a lot of improvements in the aquaculture in India because of Blue Revolution, especially with respect to new techniques of fish breeding, fish rearing, fish marketing and also fish export. These three were the broad objectives of the Blue Revolution: mechanical and technical development, encouragement to aquaculture, and facility of cooperative and marketing. What were the achievements of the Blue Revolution? There were many achievements. So for example, the states like Andhra, Tamil Nadu, they developed shrimp farming in a big way. In fact, the Nellore district in Andhra is known as the shrimp capital of India. There are more than 1800 species of fish that are found in India. So India has a very broad, you know, India is very fish biodiversity rich. The fish in India are found both in the seas and in the inland water, that is the rivers, etc. And a lot of fish are commercially important. These are some of the names of the fish that are commercially important in India, like salmon, rohu, tuna, carps, you know, featherback. I mean, all sorts of fish are there. And not only fish, there are prawns and, you know, herrings, etc. Now, it was during the 8th five-year plan, which was the next one from 1992 to 1997, the intensive marine fisheries program was launched in India, in which collaboration with multinational companies was encouraged. This is to promote investment in this sector. And it was during this time that a lot of fishing harbors were created in India during the Blue Revolution. Like for example, Tuticorin, Porbandar, Onavar, Vishakhapatnam, Kochi, Kandla, Port Blair, etc. These were all developed as a fishing harbor. There were a lot of research centers also that were set up to increase the production and improvement in the species of fish. So for example, we have a research center in Barakpur, Kolkata, for freshwater fish. Then we have a center, research center in Mumbai and Mandapam in Tamil Nadu for the marine fish, that is the saltwater fish. Then we have a Central Fish Research Institute, which is in Mumbai. And we have a Central Institute of Fisheries and Nautical Engineering Training, which is in Kochi. And the CMFRI, Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute, is also in Kochi. So what is the target that we have set? Our target is to have 15 million ton of fish production by 2020. Current it is about 10 million ton. So we want to increase it by 1.5 times in the next 18 months, because 2020 is now only 18 months away, the end of 2020. And then we want to raise it further to 20 million ton by 2020-23. So this is a very ambitious target. It won't be easy to grow the fishery sector 1.5 times in just next 1.5 years. But we have kept an ambitious target of around 15 million ton by 2020 and 20 million ton by 2022-23. This you must remember. What is the current status of India with respect to fisheries? What is the present scenario? It is very important. So fisheries and aquaculture, you know, they support over 14 million fishermen in India and several others, their family members, etc. They are involved in the value chain. So not only fish catching of a fish, there is an entire process that happens later on. So for example, the cleaning of the fish, then processing of the fish, etc. And then transport, etc. Because ultimately we have 9 coastal states and 4 union territories, which are coastal, right? So 9 coastal states, on the western coast, you know, from Gujarat to West Bengal, we have the coastal India where fishing is done. But also in those places which are, I mean, there are union territories also which have a coastline. Like for example, Andaman Nicobar or Lakshadweep or Diu, Puducherry. So there are 13 total states plus union territories where fishing is done in India. Now remember, 10% of the global biodiversity of fish is found in India. This is very important. This shows how much rich biodiversity we have. Different varieties of species of fish we have in India, which is 1800 plus. So that accounts for 10% of the global biodiversity, both in terms of brackish water and freshwater fishes. And where do we stand in the world total? So China is number one. It is the leading producer of fish in the world, and we are a close number two. So India accounts for 6.3% of the global fish production. India is second in the world in terms of fish production. And not only that, the fishery sector contributes 1.1% to the GDP and 5.15% to the agriculture GDP. Clear? These are very important figures for your mains exam. Also, India's fish production is, as I said, it is 10 million ton. We want to increase it to 15 million ton by 2020. So India is the second largest fish producing country. What about the exports? 10% of all the exports of India are fisheries, and 20% of the agriculture exports are fisheries. And why this is important is because we have kept a target that by 2022, we should have agriculture exports from India worth $60 billion. And if we are to achieve this target, then the growth of fisheries is very important, because fishery is nothing but it is an agriculture allied activity. In fact, we have only one ministry. We don't have a separate ministry for fisheries. The ministry is called the Ministry for Agriculture, Agriculture, Dairying and Fisheries, headed by now Mr. Giriraj Singh. So that was about the Matsya Sampada Yojana and the current fisheries sector. Now let's take a look at some other important issues with respect to fish. Now there is one fish called tuna, and it has a lot of potential in Indian context, but we have not realized the potential of tuna. Tuna fish has become very important because of the high demand in the international markets. So recently in Hyderabad, we had the 23rd session of the Indian Ocean Tuna Commission. They met in Hyderabad, and there the Fisheries Department of India, they pitched for a level playing field in the exclusive economic zone of the Indian Ocean for fishing tuna. And also United Nations has decided to celebrate 2nd of May as World Tuna Day. So only 2 years back, this day was commissioned by the United Nations. Now 2nd of May every year is the World Tuna Day. So every country gets a particular area of the sea or the ocean where it has exclusive rights for fishing. That is the exclusive economic zone. Now the problem is India has a very wide EEZ economic zone in the ocean, but only 1% India contributes to the production of tuna fish. So the market is huge. In fact, the global tuna market is around $11 billion. and it is growing. It is expected to grow to almost 14 billion by 2023. And in spite of having such a huge coastline, which starts from Gujarat ends in West Bengal, you know, 13 states plus union territory, the country is yet to tap the tuna opportunity. So we must do more to increase the production of tuna. It is like we are sitting on a gold mine. And you should know something about the Indian Ocean Tuna Commission also. The commission met recently in Hyderabad. But what is it? So basically, it is an intergovernmental organization. It is a grouping of various countries for the exchange of knowledge, exchanging notes, technology for better production and management of tuna and tuna-like species in the Indian Ocean. Indian Ocean Tuna Commission is headquartered in the island of Seychelles. Now let's talk about another opportunity that India is missing, which is ornamental fishing. Now, what are ornamental fishes? They are basically colored, beautiful looking fishes, which are basically reared for their aesthetic qualities and not for consumption. So for example, the fishes that you see in aquarium, hotels and hospitality business, those are all ornamental fishes. So what is the opportunity that India is missing? First of all, in 2018, in order to develop the ornamental fish industry, there was a project that was started by Indian government, which is called India Network Project on Ornamental Fish Breeding and Culture. Under this project was started by two organizations. One is, of course, CMFRI, which is Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute, which is in Kochi, and ICAR, Indian Council of Agriculture Research, for the growth of the ornamental fishes in India. Under this, there were seven institutes that were set up. Okay, these are the seven institutes. Now you don't need to know the names of these, but just remember, these are very important institutes with respect to the ornamental fishes. There was a joint research initiative under this project. The aim is basically to increase the culture of freshwater and marine ornamental species, to make it a sustainable industry, to have good, adequate technologies in fish breeding. So where in India will you find the marine ornamental fish and the freshwater one? Marine ornamental fish are found in, you know, Andaman Nicobar, Lakshadweep, Gulf of Mannar and Gulf of Kutch. And the freshwater ornamental fish you will find in the Western Ghats. That is essentially the area of the Konkan coast, Kenra coast and the Malabar coast. And you will also find it in the rivers of the Northeast India. These are the freshwater ornamental fish. And India is lucky to have both very rich biodiversity of both marine as well as freshwater ornamental fish. Remember, the government of India, they have identified ornamental fish as a thirst area for the development of the fishery sector. And it is central to our exports. We can export ornamental fish because the demand is growing. Initially, like in early days, you often saw aquariums only in hotels and hospitality business. But now aquariums are very common in even the people's homes. So the demand for ornamental fish is ever increasing. And India must do more to develop this sector. There is a huge potential. Also remember, recently India's first technology park for ornamental fishes, that is Aquatic Rainbow Technology Park as it is called, it was opened in Chennai. It was opened in Chennai. And remember, West Bengal in India is the largest exporter of ornamental fish and Tamil Nadu comes a close second. Okay, so Tamil Nadu and West Bengal is number one, Tamil Nadu is number two. These are the biggest exporters of the ornamental fish. Now let's see important 2-3 developments also with respect to the fishery sector. You should be aware of what is current is happening in the fishery sector. So recently, International Union for Conservation of Nature, which is called IUCN, you know, they have a red list where they put threatened species and they have a very, you know, very big classification also, like extinct, extinct in the wild, critically endangered, endangered, like that. So there is one fish which is found in India, very, very important. It is called humpback mahaseer. And this fish did not even have a scientific name. So first IUCN, what they did, they gave it a scientific name. This is very latest in 2019. They called it Thor Rame Devi. Because without giving a scientific name, you can't classify a fish. You can't classify an animal as endangered or critically endangered into the Red Data Book. It is important. It is customary that for including it in the Red Data Book, it has to be given a scientific name. So the humpback mahaseer was given a name, Thor Rame Devi. And it was declared as critically endangered. Now remember, this is the, in the diagram that you see, it is the humpback mahaseer fish. It is very big in size and it is called Tiger of Kaveri because it is very common in the Kaveri River in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. But also it is found in the Kerala's some small rivers like Pambar, Kabini and Bhavani. And now it is critically endangered. Now remember, not all people are happy with humpback mahaseer. A lot of fishermen, they say it is an invasive species, which means it is responsible for degrowth or decrease in the number of the indigenous species that we have. So it is acting like an invasive species. Recently, India's first mega aqua food park has been opened. Although there are many food parks in India that have been opened in various states, but this is the first aqua food park, which means only seafood processing will be done here. And it was inaugurated in the West Godavari district in Andhra Pradesh. And the Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute, they have proposed, and this is very important, please create a separate fisheries ministry. Because right now, we have the ministry called for agriculture, dairying and fisheries all in one. And therefore, there is no concentrated effort to grow the fisheries sector. If we have a separate ministry for that, then the effort could be more channelized, it can be more converged. So there needs to be more coordinated, better coordinated effort in the growth of the fisheries sector, but also the conservation in the fisheries sector. And there was a formalin issue that was in news. Formalin issue is basically this, that in states, almost in all the states, there is a chemical called formalin that is used to preserve the fish. So it is used as a preservative. And the problem is, it is used to keep the fishes more viable. Otherwise, they will decompose, right? So it is used as a preservative. The problem started when it was found that the formalin is a very important cancer-causing chemical. It is a carcinogenic chemical. And it can lead to kidney problems. It can lead to skin problem if came in contact. And therefore, the government even banned the import of, interstate transport of the fish between Kerala and other states. In fact, Kerala, Karnataka, there were a lot of places where because of formalin, the fishing activity was banned for a while, because this can lead to serious health issue. And then there are other issues like marine pollution. You know, our oceans are becoming more warmer and they are becoming more acidic. And because of that, we see things like coral bleaching. And if there is a coral bleaching, if corals will die, then the food of the fishes will also die. Also, overfishing. This is another very important issue. Overfishing, habitat degradation, because a lot of fishes, they live inside the corals. Corals provide them protection also. Climate change, market stagnation, these are other issues. So if there is a dedicated ministry, then exclusive attention could be given to these important issues. So this was regarding the fishery sector in India and Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. Now it remains to be seen how this scheme will unfold in the days to come. But a broad outline has been already. It is in public domain that I shared with you. And I also shared important points about the fishery sector in India. I hope you liked and enjoyed the video. If you did, give me a thumbs up. I brought to you this video. My name is Dr. Gaurav Garg. I'm signing off. I'll see you in some other video. Thank you so much and take care.